Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today we start a new playlist in where I will speak about machine learning and MLOps in Databricks. I have already uploaded some videos where the topic was not essentially Databricks, was MLflow, but I started to introduce what is possible to do with Databricks. And now we are going to start with the topic itself, how to run projects, ML projects, or run machine learning, and also MLOps in Databricks. And today we will start with an important topic that is the RESTful API. Probably most of you know, if you already know the technology, you probably interact with MLflow using the interface, the UI, but probably you don't know that everything that you can do here in the interface is also possible to be done via two different ways. Additionally, one is the RESTful API, the REST API, which allow you to interact with any of the functionalities that you had available there, and also using the command line interface. This is also something that I already discussed, how to create how to install the command line interface and interact with Databricks. But we will have a video where we cover completely the CLI as well. Today we will cover the API, the REST API. The REST API is available on the three, well, Databricks is available in the three main cloud providers, Amazon, Google Cloud, and Azure. We already saw in a video, you have it on the channel, how to install install a workspace, how to create a workspace, how to create a cluster, how to create the CLI and connect your local environment with the CLI. And we saw some videos in especially dedicated to MLflow, how to create submit jobs, submit experiments to use the MLflow that is an integral part of Databricks Workspace. We didn't cover so much. We just again create a cluster, and we just look at the necessary that we need to do the jobs MLflow experiments. Because I didn't want to enter in deep on MLflow, because I was waiting to start this series. Today we will cover the API. I suppose that you are familiar with the technology. It's not well, I will create in any case a second video where we will cover all the stuff. We can be look at how to say short run in what we had here. In any case, the UI is changing, the same that everything around Databricks change every month is crazy. I'm working with them for more than 5 years, and then the evolution of Databricks is well, in terms of the business, is exponential. The practically all the companies I've been working for in the past 5 years, all of them use Databricks. It doesn't matter if you use it in Amazon, Google. Google joined recently, 2 years ago, I don't remember when. Azure, yeah, all of them the same. There is some small differences in how you access the resources, but well, when you are inside the UI, it's practically 99% the same regardless the provider you had or you are using. And then there is now, well, probably you know that we can use in Databricks four languages, plus SQL, you can use Python, Python PySpark, Scala, Java and R. The platform itself is developed in Scala, so meaning that the rest of the language has an API which transform the your language PySpark or R or Java in even SQL to directives in Scala, which are the ones that later on are executed on the core, on Database core or Spark core, because at the end of the day Database is not more than a commercial version of the Spark. And well, again, this is changing constantly, especially since the adoption of generative AI as well in the platform. The UI is changing very quickly, so there is now catalogs and especially here the part of machine learning. You can, some of the stats I cannot access because I have a trial. So for next videos I will try to work on the community edition, and if not I will upgrade at least for some days the trial to a commercial one, and well, we will be able to cover how to work with the generative AI and prompts and all the fantastic stuff that you can do here. So the advantage, obviously, to work in this platform, you have access to work with big data, and obviously with distributed computer, which is slightly more complicated than to work in a conventional environment with multiple machines. So we have here two paradigms. One is this, and the other is the multiple computers working on containers. That could be the option that there is, how to say, kind of this, of people who prefer a platform like distributed platform like Database, or another prefer a platform that with like Kubernetes, where you work with multiple containers at the same time, and you can scale as well horizontally and vertically. This is another paradigm. Is here you work with clusters. Clusters are groups of computers, in this case, which are governed essentially by a driver, a component which is the driver aspect, the driver is not more one of the nodes of the cluster, which has an special components which is coordinating the activities in all of the components which have the name of workers. There is also a scheduler, there is different components which essentially is creating the ecosystem of components that have Databricks, and well, many people prefer to work in this environment. The truth is that with Databricks you can connect practically with everything. You can cover practically all the analytics life cycle, not only the machine learning, because here is also a tool really prepared to work in the data engineering side, which others are not that competent in that matter. No? For the topic of machine learning, you can work here with conventional machine learning libraries, machine learning, deep learning, or transformers, and also LLMs. Yeah, you can work with them as well, and you can serve models as well. You can create experiments with MLflow or the study of machine learning, and also you can work with distributed machine learning with the MLlib platform, MLlib library, which essentially only works on top of a Spark platform. This is something that you cannot do, obviously, in other environments. To work with MLlib, you need to be in a Spark environment, with the and the libraries are ready to work with Spark data frames or with and with Spark technology. So we will do a deep dive in all the technologies. It is necessary. I suppose that most of you, when you are connecting, is because you already know the technology, and that's why we will move directly to review the API. Again, everything that you can do here on the UI, you can do it today on the API. I have prepared a short demonstration of some of the capabilities of the actions that you can do through the API. You can do practically the same using the CLI, so we will cover this in another video. And why I'm speaking about API and CLI, because this is quite connected as well with MLOps. Usually when you are creating a CI/CD pipeline, you interact with Databricks using the API or using the CLI. You install you need to, for example, create a cluster, create a workspace, move notebooks to the workspace. This is done essentially either using the API or using the CLI, depending which components are you including in your deployment pipeline and also in your building pipeline. And then we will cover today some examples. Everything that you will see here is applicable to AWS, GCP or Azure with some, changes with what is specific of the provider. I will let you know, and then you will have to look at the specific documentation in Amazon, Google or Azure to understand what is the value. But many times, especially creating a computer, for example, when you create a computer, you always can take a look to how this can be done in your provider. And you see here these Azure attributes. I'm 100% sure that there is an Google Cloud attributes, Amazon attributes, so the node types, for example, change, the drive node type ID change, some of the label change, and some others are the same. For example, Spark version, this is regardless the cloud provider, and many of the attributes are identical, but some other may change depending on the specific cloud provider. But again, I repeat, just go to the specific activity that you want to do, as you always can. For example, we are going to see today as well just RAMs and jobs. You can go here to the job and take a look where is this? Where is this? My RUIB details. No, sorry, I think no, this is not here. No, it's here. No. No, sorry, it's and today here is in jobs. You can take a look in a view YAML JSON, and you can take a look what are the necessary parameters. You can export JSON API. You see here you can export, practically reuse the disk body and change, for example, the notebook path or the where you want to run it, etc., just to adapt it as body to your request using the notebook or using another tool. Like Postman or whatever you are using to submit the jobs. So it's quite easy to understand, and again, the differences among the providers you can very quickly review. Again, you can do this as well, the experiments, if you want to check an experiment in MLflow, you as well, come on, sometimes it's taking a while. So you always, where is that? I remember that here, probably. No, here, no. Well, somewhere you will have as well the how to translate this to a Ember Flow request. In any case, to submit an experiment, you will see here we are going to do one or to review. You can go first of all, go to the documentation, check what is demanded for that specific stat, machine learning experiments or model registry. You can get here, create an experiment, what do you need, the name, artifact location, tags, and that's it. So you don't need anything more. And then here you have an example. In many of them you have examples on how to build the request. The requests are post and get, very simple. For people who work with APIs, is, well, you probably don't need to be an specialist and a subject matter expert to understand this. It's just copy the URL, create the body, and submit the request using the appropriate method. This is what we are going to do here. Apart from that, you need two parameters, two keys. One is the Databricks host. Databricks host is this part here. From this HTTP up to here, this is the URL of your workspace. This as well is going to change depending on your cloud provider. Obviously, it's different from because this is the DNS name of your workspace, and obviously it will change here. You see this Databricks.net, Google is different, and Amazon is different. And also, you need the token. Where is that? Sorry, the Databricks tokens. This also I show you in a previous video, but I will show you again. You go to settings, you go to developer, access tokens, generate new token, write a comment, lifetime. If you write zero, is forever. It's a permanent lifetime. It's a permanent token. It is not applied the number of days that you set up here. I recommend you set up 1 year maximum and renew the tokens from time to time, especially if you are using the API or the CLI, because you lose control of the at the end who is using and from where your Databricks workspace is being used. So when you generate the token, write it down because it's only appear and just here, copy, write it down because this is not going to be it's not going to be shown anymore. So you need these two configuration parameters just to submit the jobs. It doesn't matter if it is a get or it is a post, you will need both. And both, one is used to the URL. The URL is essentially the host plus the method or the entry point or the API that you want to use. And the token is using for the authorization headers. So these headers, you are including them in the request, in the post and in the guest request, and also the URL. Obviously, you are posting or getting something from a URL, which essentially the root is your workspace plus a entry point. So here we are going to submit a job. We can submit it or create it. We are going to use both in order you to see it. First of all, we will do a submit, or later we are going to do a create, first of all, and then on here we just create a job, we just receive a job, and then creating a job is something that will appear here. You see here, a new job, just created. If you click here, you take a look to the job ID, and the job ID matches exactly with this one. I will pass now to review what is the body here. Now we are going to do a submit. Submit means that we not just create, we just run it directly. And then here you analyze the body. I'm going to create a job, submit it, and at the same time I'm going to create a cluster. And here is what exactly is included in my job RAM. I'm going to change it now just to you see it, how it changed. So what I'm doing here, I give a name to the job RAM. The task key is what is going to appear on the job RAM in the UI. Here I'm creating a cluster. This is the parameters of the cluster: Spark version, Spark configuration, Azure attributes. Remember what I told you some moments ago, the node type ID. Again, this may change depending on the provider, and custom tags, resource class, a single node. This means that I have the driver and the worker on the same name, on the same machine. Only one box I'm going to create here. A cluster with a single machine. More parameters. I want a runtime standards, security mode legacy, the username who is owning this job, and the Elastic Disk Loop. What I'm going to do in this job, I will run this tags. The tags is a notebook. It can be a Java HAR submission, a Python script. It can be an Arc. Whatever you can do inside, every parameter, depending on the language, have different configuration. You just need to review the documentation. It's quite easy. And configure, and also, as you can see here, I'm sending a parameter to the notebook, base parameters, and when you get to the notebook itself, the notebook is that one. You see it here, the path is workspace users, my user jobs API, with this that one. And then on the parameter is just capture with DB utils, database utils, widgets that get experiment name, which is essentially what I'm writing down here, experiment. And then let's check. And okay, and then timeout 3600 seconds. This means it's the job doesn't finish at that time, it will be canceled automatically, and this some tags just to tag the job in order later on to be able to identify it easily. So we change this and we just submit as well using a different URL, obviously, because we have changed it to run submit. The same headers, because we are using the same authentication token, and the body, we just check the experiment name that changed here, and now is my job run. This, instead to be here in jobs, it will be in jobs runs, and you can see here that now is one created. And you can see here is creating now a new cluster. The parameters you can see here, it was experiment test IN, and the job ID is 718. So now it's creating the experiment. Let's move to the next and we can continue with the tutorial. Here is another way to do the same. Here we are going to use an existing cluster. How you know, you can see here that the only change is here we remove the new cluster, this part of here, and we use we replace it with existing cluster. Where we take this cluster ID, you can go to compute. You click on your cluster, and here you can see the ID of the cluster. Also, you go here, you go view JSON, you can also take it from here. Okay, so it's the same activity. I just going to change here existing. We don't change the URL, existing cluster. And we just give the parameter is a different one. Let's execute it and run in a different with a different runner 128. Now let's go to workflows, job runs, and exactly this is the one we just submit. As the cluster is already running, you can see here 128. The job is already running because the computer is already up, no? It's already working, so it's automatically running the process. You see here the parameter is getting here, and the parameter I'm capturing here with dbutils, and then on I'm using this. In workflow, in MRflow. So now it supposed that it has created an experiment with this name. If we go to experiments, jobs API, all of them are included in this notebook, and you can see here we just create this experiment moments ago, existing cluster, and is the one that is already running. It's a hyperparameter tuning experiment with hyperops. Is something that we already saw on the channel. You can take a look to this video. If you cannot find it, let me know. I will point you out where you had this experiment. And okay, also you can use pools. Pools is another way to organize your infrastructure. You can create a pool. The pool is a set of the machines or servers which share, so you have a minimum and a maximum, and all of them have the same type of instance and the same runtime. So this, you have a group of the machines not dedicated, just you have it there in a pool. You can submit jobs versus that pool. And then how it works, essentially you decide how much of the pool you want to use. Obviously you need to have at least what you are specifying here. Here one worker and one driver, when you set up this like that. And also you just specify the ID of the pool. You go here, pools, the ID of the pool, you just have it here. I will not submit this because I have no quota, but well. Now, here we are going to review. Here we have these two entry points, submit and create. There are two. Here now, we use it for all this creation of the runs and jobs. Here we are going to list the jobs. So we have two jobs here. One is the my job. And if we go here, sorry. We have it here, new job, but we had to have as well the new job. Exactly, sorry. New job and my job. Name, my job, and so we had to. So when you just want to list the jobs, you can use this entry point. You had all the documentation here. I put you here the link to the API later on when I post the notebook to the repository. You can play around with your own cluster and check that, and not only that, you can test with whatever you had available here in the. Sometimes it doesn't want to work. Okay, let me check. Compute, workflows, Delta, machine learning. Okay. Doesn't matter. You can review here everything that you can do with the API. So now you want to run the job branch, you just point to another URL and check it out. Here we are using get and also the URL and the headers. Here if you take a look to the runs, here we have a lot of information, is everything coming from this list here. So now we are going to cancel a job. Let's take that one. You just take the run ID. You just create the body. And you just post the body to the right API. You can see here, cancel it as soon as you submit the job. Now you, for example, we are going to list what I had on my workspace in this path, the objects I had in this path. So probably we can do a better print, but you can see here I had the path, what is a notebook, path, user, all or not, jobs API, language Python, created, blah, 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 MFlow experiment. Here we go to my home. What you are seeing here is this jobs API, path, pipelines, MFlow experiments, pipelines. The next is another notebook, MFlow end-to-end, and so on and so forth. Machine learning. Let's take an experiment, a run ID. You can interact with the experiments and also with the models. Let's take, I don't know, that one. Let's take whatever. Let's take, this is a hyperparameter tuning. Let's take that one. Or this one, doesn't really matter. Copy, we just get MLflow runs get, you pass the run ID, and you get all the information of that run ID. You see here 54, I don't know what we can take a look. Maybe key MLflow source name, Hotmail. Aquí, for example, K metric gamma value. Let's take a look. This gamma value 00743. Gamma. You have it here. And finally, we are going to create a cluster. And then I don't want to cover all of you because it's going to be very boring. It's everything the same. In any case, if you have any doubt how to use one of the specific entry points, let me know on the channel and I will try to solve you, help you in how to use it. But again, it's pretty simple, it's my opinion. You can create here a cluster. You see here the name is single node cluster. This is SPAR version. We are sending now here to the cluster create, post, URL, headers, body. And you can see here it returns the cluster ID. Now we can go to compute, single node cluster. You can see here the the ID, which match exactly with that. So as you can see, it's very easy to work with the API. Everything, or practically everything that you have available in the UI, you can do it through the API, practically everything. And it's not, you can circumvent or overcome the if there is any limitations. Keep in mind again that depending on the provider, you may have specific attributes just for that provider. Review the documentation of the provider and check exactly. And I show you the trick how to verify to create, for example, a compute or a pool or whatever is something is specific of that provider. You can easily identify it on the UI. Let's go to the runs to check if everything is still running. You can check here. So it's yes, yeah. Here we took the experiment. It's creating. Yeah, Exibus experiment name, Exibus experiment test IN. This is the experiment name. If we go to experiments, job API, we simply have the new experiment here. It's working. You can check here the from who booked this experiment. This is the job 1951. If you go here, job runs, here still running. So experiments, you can check here. The best trial loss is 19. Still is working. Let's take a look. I will stop. When it's finished, we will continue. Okay, once it's done, we got the status of success or failure, whatever it is, and you can essentially review what's going on in the run of this notebook, and also you can go directly to the experiment. In experiments is the one we have here. Okay, experiments. Oh my gosh, sometimes. Yep. And jobs API. You can just click here. Yes, probably it's 200 experiments, so you can just take a look here. Of the experiments, let me just check one stuff. So they say the best run ID is that one, and if you can check here, maybe it's still recording. Sometimes it takes a while after you show everything in Emberflow because it's still registering all the stuff. Here I don't see now. Range, but okay. You can check in any case here what is the best loss. Here the tags. Here the parameters of the experiment, the best model. I still didn't finish here. Yeah, again, sometimes it takes a while after you see the all the artifacts in the repository. And we are working with some Fifteen minutes ago. Something strange here. I don't know what's going on. Maybe we need to refresh. Yeah, leave me 1 second to refresh again. Okay, that's all. I think that there is an issue on the notebook at the time that we register the models and we pass it to the production. This is something that we will discuss in another video. But you can see here that there is I had a bug on the notebook. And then I'm not, moving correctly the models to archive. And that's why, well, probably it's a little bit a mix on that, a mess, no? On that notebook. But in any case, that this is not essentially the purpose. The purpose is to see what we can do with the API, which is, again, practically everything. And again, if you had any issues with the one specific entry point, let me know. I can take a look and show you an example and how you can interact with that specific entry point in your cloud provider. And that's all. I will post later in the description of the video the link to the notebook. And then you can play around with them in your own environment. And that's all. We start this series of videos. We will speak about ML and MLOps with Databricks. We already did some stuff that you can also review. I also created a specific playlist for that. You can review on the channel. And well, again, thank you very much for watching. Give me a like if you like the content and you find it interesting and useful for your job or your training. And subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before, and share with your friends and colleagues if you think that it can be useful for them as well. And that way, you help me to promote the channel. Thank you very much. Bye bye.